mankind attempts to fabricate great works of once magnificent and impossible. On desert sands, from mountains of stone, a pyramid, from flying fortresses alone, a wall of light. A chapel ceiling screaming one man's ecstasy, one man's ecstasy. Miracles, them all, China's endless wall, Stonehenge, the Parthenon, the Duomo, the aqueducts of Rome. We did not attempt to make with mammoth blocks of stone a giant pyramid. No, not a pyramid. No Gothic walls that radiate with light. Our task was to dream upon and then create a floating city, floating city. A human metropolis, a complete civilization, sleek and fast, at once a poem and the perfection of physical engineering. At once a poem and the perfection of physical engineering. How do they build Titanic? Near 1,000 feet in length. Huge beyond past endeavor, strong beyond mortal strength. 46,000 tons of steel, 11 stories high. She's a great palace.
Captain. Pastor Gordon, this ready to go to sea, Captain.
Lower the gangways, Mr. Pittman.
Gangways are all lowered, sir.
Make fast the tugs.
Tugs are all fast, sir.
Let go all lines.
Let go of the bow lines. Let go of the stern lines. Let go of the offsprings.
Tow her off, Mr. Pittman.
Our present course.
West by north, 281 degrees, sir.
Steady as she goes, quartermaster.
Aye, Captain.
Mr. Lightoller, what's our present speed?
19 knots, sir.
Maintain 19 knots, Mr. Murdoch.
Aye, aye, sir.
Boiler rooms 1 through 6, maintain 68 revolutions of the wing propellers.
EJ! Now that we're officially underway, I thought a little celebration might be in order.
I'm sorry, Mr. Ismay. I don't allow alcohol on my bridge. You know that, Mr. Retches.
Yes, sir, I do.
Technically, EJ, it could be considered my bridge.
Not at sea, Mr. Ismay.
I'm terribly sorry, sir. I'm afraid this bottle seems to have gone completely flat. I couldn't possibly allow you to drink it. Would you like me to fetch you another, Mr. Ismay?
Oh, never mind. Let it go.
Thank you, sir. Again, my apologies.
Thank you, Mr. Etches.
Yes, well, with or without champagne, I would like us to make a toast to the Royal Mail steamer Titanic, nearly a quarter mile in length. She's bigger, grander, and safer than any ship in history. The greatest achievement in the transatlantic navigation since that very first crossing 420 years ago. Andrews, I'm glad you're here. I was just congratulating the three of us on our magnificent contribution to the 20th century. Progress, gentlemen! I give you progress!
I trust you'll excuse us, Mr. Ismay. We have our duties.
Oh, EJ, what's our present speed?
19 knots, Mr. Ismay.
Really? I would have expected us to be going faster now that we've cleared land. I want us to make New York by Tuesday afternoon. Now, Andrews, I understand that 22 knots would be necessary in order to make a six-day crossing. So, in your expert opinion, is Titanic capable of that speed? Oh, come, Andrews. You're the one who built the thing. Are we capable of 22 knots?
Capable? Yes, sir. I'm sure we are. Possibly a bit more if pushed 23.
Ah,
perhaps.
Excellent. I'm very pleased to hear it.
But it is customary for a maiden voyage to proceed prudently.
It's the maiden voyage that creates news, and I intend for this one to create a legend. So answer me straight, man. When can we expect to run at full speed?
When the captain orders it, sir.
Then we must persuade him to do so, mustn't we?
As a point of fact, Mr. Ismay, I was just about to give the order when you walked in. Mr. Murdoch, increase speed to 20 knots.
20 knots, aye aye, sir. Increase steam, Mr. Bell. Give us 71 revolutions.
20 knots. Well, it's a start, I suppose. Carry on, gentlemen.
Watch your compass, Mr. Richards. You're drifting off course.
I don't think
so. Don't argue with me, man. If I say you're off course, then you're bloody well off course.
Set your screws to 71, Mr. Barrett.
71? If you ask me, Mr. Bell, it's a mite soon for 71.
Well, it's captain's orders, if you have no objections, that is.
It's his ship, isn't it? 71 it shall be. But I'll speak plain, Mr. Bell. If it was my ship, I wouldn't recommend her speed increase too quick.
Do as you're told, Mr. Barrett.
She's sparkling clean, this newborn ship, but one old thing is clear. The orders they propose above, we execute down here. We'll watch from here as up above, they'll catch a whiff of glory. This wonder ship may be brand new, but it's the same old story. Stoke the fire in the hold as the men draw back. Feed the heat in the hold as the men draw back. And the dust of the coal in the air is black, and a trickle of sweat runs down your back. And what are the boys from the Midlands doing here? Coal it is that makes the steam, that runs the machines that run the world, that send the men below the ground to mine the coal. Each day from Leicestershire and Nottingham, us lads who work down in the pit knew if you'd got above the ground, you'd save your soul. Some way get out of the pit, and westward I knew I could run and ship out to sea, and there my new life was begun. And the screws are turning at 71. It became my dream to go out to sea. Further out from the mine you couldn't be, but born to the coal, there's no place for you elsewhere. You trade a life of dank and gloom to shovel in the boiler room, but now you're seven decks below a lady's dainty feet. And nothing has changed, there's nothing a miner can do. The pit and your mates turned into the hold and the crew. And the screws are turning at 72. Faster and faster we watch as we gain ever more. 73 and too soon, it is 74. For record speed I believe we strive, for the maiden ship that's too hard to drive. If you push her faster than 75, that is the truth, I swear.
dining saloon. Saloon?
Come on, Alice. They want us to get to our own saloon.
Did you get a good look at John Jacob Astor? He looks exactly like his picture.
So do you, Alice.
Oh, Edgar, this is so exciting. Almost every famous millionaire in the whole world is on this ship. And to think, we'll actually be rubbing elbows with them. How impressed they'll all be when they hear all that you know about hardware.
Well, I wouldn't exactly count on rubbing elbows with them, Alice. They won't let us peasants in second class go anywhere near those people in there.
What's the point of being on the same boat if we can't hobnob with them? It's bad enough we have to make do with that dinky cabin they gave us and those two silly little bunk beds.
Well, we don't have to use the top one, Alice.
Calm down, Edgar. I'm telling you right now, I'm going in there. If it's the last thing I do, I'm going in there.
Dagnabbit, Alice.
Language, Edgar.
They don't want us in there. They want us right here, where we are. That's all we paid for, and that's all we get.
Well, that's not all I'm getting.
Rich people, darling.
Of course they're rich, darling. They're Americans. Can't you just imagine what they'll all be jabbering about? All those things my father lives for. International banking, venture capital, cornering the market, you know, that sort of thing.
How would I know that sort of thing, Caroline? My father never had a corner on the market. All he ever had was a market on the corner. I told you running away with me would be educational.
Caroline, aren't you thrilled? Finally now, you'll see what second class looks like.
Oh, Charles, I love it when you're sarcastic. It makes me feel like we're a real married couple.
Why not? That's what we would be if your snob of a father had permitted it. And that's what we will be the minute we arrive in America.
Darling, considering our living arrangements. Everyone on board thinks we're already married.
You know we would have separate cabins if I could afford them.
Yes, but separate cabins would have meant separate beds, Charles.
Well, we had to make do with what we had, didn't we? You don't suppose we'll burn in hell for it, do you?
Stop worrying, darling. In America, it's not a sin at all.
What isn't?
Saving money.
My dear Mr. Latimer, prepare to greet our clientele. Our meeting is imminent. Our having just rung the dinner bell, it won't be a novelty. We mostly have seen them all before. Prepare for the usual. You should be aware of what's in store. We've served them on the Baltic and the Oceanic, Olympic and Majestic, and today's the same. There's nothing changed. Mr. Astor takes his toast dry. Mrs. Strauss likes the grouse, the sauce on the side. And the Wideners love kidney pie. Bring it hot, if it's not, they'll be fit to be tied. They're accustomed to the best of all that money buys. The world of free enterprise has given this privilege to the rich. When they're idle, they're entitled to the luxury which we provide. That's forever the source of our pride, which is why we're always there with our especial form of care for every hungry millionaire. By now they all arrived.
We're sailing aboard the greatest ship that ever sailed the seas. The Holland, the Kiel, and Burby, yes, the stronger by degrees.
Magnificent crystal chandeliers, parquet, and all the floors.
The Sicilian Jacoby, and the other core of the world adores.
Remarkable ship, oh, remarkable ship,
oh,
remarkable ship.
Out of an airplane, remarkable things go endlessly from out the human brain.
whom we happily serve. Here they dine on fine French cuisine. It's the creme de la creme's most exclusive preserve. It's the pleasure of the leisure class's greatest wits to be where the captain sits when taking their dinner on the sea. Giving deference to their preferences is our chief art. We play our part in a properly working machine. You should ever be aware this is a privilege great and rare, a special burden that we bear in our respective lives.
Remarkable U.S. steel is splitting shares of 5-4. Monopoly makes the industry far better than before.
Attending the coronation of the George of England.
And I will rock the monarchy to frolic in the sand.
Remarkable toast! Remarkable toast! Remarkable toast! So much surprise and amaze!
And what a remarkable time! What a remarkable world! What a remarkable land! It's the Hall of the Guild of various magnificent crystal chandeliers, our fellows invented seen the throne, and what a remarkable age this is!
Is now being served in the first class dining saloon.
Never forget my last tour in India during the Tirah campaign of 97 to reopen the Khyber Pass when we were ambushed by 8,000 crazed, godless savages who attacked without
a fight. EJ! Have you ever had so many distinguished Americans in your charge at one time? Of course, everyone knows the Major.
Of course. Welcome aboard. Mr. Guggenheim, you're becoming quite a regular on the Atlantic run.
Yes, in point of fact, this is my 34th crossing.
EJ, you haven't told us how many miles we covered yesterday.
484, Mr. Ismay.
And are you pleased with that?
Yes, I am, sir. It's better than I expected for the first day.
Then I'm sure we'll do even better today.
Begging your pardon, Captain, Mr. Hitchens has requested his course.
Increase speed, Mr. Murdoch, to 21 knots, and tell Mr. Hitchens to set course at west, northwest, 292 degrees.
That's the northern track, sir.
I'm well aware of that, Mr. Murdoch. It'll save us both coal and time. At least 3 hours.
3 hours? Well done, EJ. Well done.
That dinner seating for Friday, April 12th is now being served in the first class dining saloon.
Don't believe I told you about my forced march to the Sudan during the winter of 85 to relieve the attack on Chinese Gordon by the Mahdi and 6,000 of his crazed, godless savages who came down with their speed.
EJ, I'm sure we're all quite anxious to know about yesterday's mileage.
519, Mr. Ismay.
Much better.
I'm so sorry to disturb your meal, Captain.
Who the devil are you?
Second wireless operator Bride, sir, with the Marconi International Marine Signal Communications Telegraphy Company, Limited.
What is it, Mr. Bride?
A message, sir, from the Furness liner Rappahannock, 4 days out of Halifax. She reports an iceberg at four...
Thank you, Mr. Bride. I can read.
Right. I mean, aye, aye, sir.
That dinner seating for Saturday, April 13th is now being served in the first class dining saloon.
But the proudest moment of my entire career came in '02 under the command of Kitchener at Johannesburg when untold thousands of crazed, godless savages appeared with the...
Mrs. Astor, I understand this is your first trip to Europe?
But not her last, Mrs. Weisner. Certainly not her last.
And how did you find Paris, Mrs. Astor?
Thank goodness I didn't have to. Jake knew right where it was.
Of course.
Excuse me, Captain.
Yes, Mr. Lightoller?
Do you have any instructions, sir, concerning our present speed?
Maintain 21 knots, Mr. Lightoller.
21 knots? Aye, sir.
21 knots? Oh, come, EJ. I promised these gentlemen that we would arrive in New York before nightfall Tuesday. At this rate, we'll never make it.
I'm afraid it's too soon for either of us to say, Mr. Ismay. I trust you forgive me. Please continue with your meal.
Oh, must you leave us, Captain?
Unfortunately, Mrs. Thayer, my duties on the bridge, though not nearly so pleasant as sitting here with you attractive ladies, requires my attention. Please excuse me.
Remarkable man, our Captain Smith.
Remarkable man, our Captain Smith. Remarkable man, our Captain Smith. Remarkable man, our Captain Smith.
What's our position, Mr. Murdoch?
Latitude 4235 north, longitude 4550 west, Captain.
And the sea temperature, Mr. Lightoller?
Last check down 5 degrees to 34 Fahrenheit, sir.
Another communication, Captain. Ice warning from the Caronian.
Another one?
They've sighted a large berg at 4150 north by 4952 west.
Brought the position with the other reports we've received.
It's directly on our new course, sir.
Not to worry. At least 600 miles out.
Still,
Not to worry. Keep a sharp eye, eh? And Mr. Murdoch, increase speed to 22 knots.
22, Captain?
Yes. Let's do everything we can to avoid bringing Mr. Ismay to the bridge again.
Yes, sir. Engine room. Increase speed to 78 revolutions of the wing propellers.
If I remember correctly, Mr. Murdoch, you qualified for your master's papers when you were only 25. Youngest man in the line's history. But here you are, still, without a ship of your own. What are you waiting for, Mr. Murdoch?
The master of a ship carries a heavy responsibility, Captain.
Every single minute, Mr. Murdoch.
I'm just not certain I'm up to it, sir.
A ship's master must be certain of everything, Mr. Murdoch, even when he's not. And I'm as certain of that as I am that this is my final crossing.
Captain!
After 43 years of service, I informed the line of my wish to retire. But they asked me to stay on, to see them through the maiden voyage. My wife was disappointed, of course. But how could I refuse? Take over, Mr. Murdoch.
On board, each in his class, you are the master of all that must pass. Yours to set course,
class passengers, third class passengers are reminded not to take food below to your cabins.
What's the reason for that, then?
It encourages the rats.
They got rats on a brand new ship.
They're always the first aboard.
Well, they're welcome to have a part of my share. Sure, and me entire family can live a week off just what I've been leaving on me plate, and all of it for free.
Free? Are you daft, then? And why do you suppose they charge us every bit of 60 shillings for our passage? What do I need with all this fine cloth and electrical light?
Well, Jim Farrell, I'm going to have fine cloth, electrical light, and a whole lot more when I get to America, including my own personal bathtub. I'm going to rise straight to the top, I will, just like cream. I will be a proper person. People will look up to me. What a girl, that girl McGowan, Katie, Violet, Maud, Marie. I aspire to heights of glory in the new world that can be. In that grandest nation, I'll stand tall. Reach my very highest hopes of all. I'm aiming to have a real profession, I am.
Me too.
Me three.
I want to be a ladies' maid in America. In America, the streets are paved with gold.
I want to be a governess, governess in America. In America, it's better, I am told.
I want to be a sewing girl in America. In America, I'll sew till I am old. There's a place called Chicago. I've seen it on the map.
There's a place called Maryland. I've seen it on the map.
There's a place in America called Albuquerque. And I'm hoping it's a bit like Donegal. Oh, I'm hoping that it is.
There, I'm hoping that it is.
Where am I dreaming? Am I hoping? Am I scheming? Am I praying? Am I wishing to be happy?
The streets are paved with gold.
I want a shop to call my own.
I want to be a millionaire in America, striking riches with the fortune I amass.
I want to be a constable in America. In America, you rise above your class.
Oh, there's a place to.
It's turning bloody cold, isn't it, Mr. Lightholder?
Yes, it feels more rather like February than April.
Andrews, there you are. I've been looking for you everywhere. I want your opinion on how you think the crossing is going so far.
Not as well as I'd hoped, Mr. Ismay. We've got a few problems.
Really? Such as what?
I'm disappointed in the water pressure levels on the upper decks. And the kitchen staff are complaining that their sleeping quarters are overheated.
There's gratitude for you. You know, in my father's day, they were lucky to get any heat at all. Now, tell me something, Andrews. Are you satisfied with our current speed?
I think so, sir.
Well then, I don't mind telling you that I'm very disappointed. The sea is calm, the weather's fair. Why aren't we going faster?
We're doing 22 knots, Mr. Ismay. That's faster than any White Star ship has ever managed.
Answer me straight, Andrews. You chaps at Harland and Wolf built the Cunard ship too. Was Titanic intentionally designed to run slower?
I really must protest the implication, Mr. Ismay. When your father ran the line, he demanded safety and comfort before speed. Cunard may get their passengers there a little faster, yes, but White Star gives them a far better ride.
It's a new world, Andrews. These days, people want speed above everything else. You know, Americans would gladly lose their dinner over the rail if it meant getting to New York a day sooner.
Mr. Ismay, was there something you wanted, sir?
EJ, I want you to now predict with any certainty are arriving in New York by Tuesday afternoon?
I can only say it's possible.
Possible? But it's imperative. If we have to stand off until Wednesday morning, our return to England will be delayed a full 24 hours. Titanic must be known as a six-day ship, EJ. Even the bloody Krauts can do it. Have second-rate tubs like Deutschland and Kaiser Wilhelm can make a turnaround by fortnight, then so, by God, shall we!
I'm sure we will do everything we can, Mr. Ismay.
Splendid. That's all one can ask for, isn't it?
Excuse me!
Who's there?
Barrett! Barrett!
Oh, the stoker!
I remember you. Welcome to the most important place on the whole ship. What can I do for you, Barrett?
I heard you could actually send a message back to England.
You heard right, all right. Sitting right here, I can communicate with important people all over the world.
Yeah?
Yes, I would explain to you how it works, but hold on. There's a message coming in. Iceberg warning from the Baltic. Hey, that's your old ship, isn't it?
Yeah.
Anyways, you can see I'm very busy, Barrett. So what is it that you want?
Well, shouldn't the captain know about the iceberg, then?
Eh, not to worry about it. I already sent him half a dozen messages just like it. If you ask me, though, they don't know what the bloody hell they're doing up there. Pardon my French. It's like we say in the telegraphy business. You can't be a radio operator and remain a Christian.
So, how much would it cost to send a message back to my girl in England? Sort of a romantic message.
Very pretty, but romantic or not, minimum rate is £4.02.
Two bloody quid! That's twice what they pay me to America and back!
Hold on. Perhaps I could give you a professional's discount.
Yeah? What'd that cost?
Nothing. They'll never know the difference.
That's all very much. You must be a romantic sort of person yourself.
Oh, no, not me. Romance and telegraphy don't mix, you see. How can you communicate with one person when you've got the entire world talking to you? I'll need her name and address and...
Darlene Watkins, Bilsthorpe, Nottinghamshire. What's that you're doing?
Darlene Watkins, Bilsthorpe, Nottinghamshire. So what's the rest of it?
I don't know. It's got to be just the right thing. Darlene's sort of funny, you see. She said if I wouldn't take her serious, she knew somebody who would. And I'm not due back for almost 2 weeks yet, so I might as well come straight out with it. I'll be coming back to you, Darlene. Back to your dark eyes and hair. Marry me when I return, darling. And until that day, my love, take care. Be thee well. May the Lord who watches all watch over thee. May God's heaven be your blanket as you softly sleep. Marry me when you're finally in my arms, you'll plainly see this devoted sailor's heart and soul are yours to keep. Yours to keep.
Every day from GMOM, good morning, old man, to GNOM, good night, old man. My telegraph sends its messages to ships at sea, sending out its dit dit da dit da dit 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 da dit da dit 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 da dit da dit. I was young and shy, detached and sad. Spent my days indoors, a homebound lad. Hardly spoke, few friends. I kept myself to myself, quite alone. Then I found Marconi's telegraph. It could span the planet's width by half. 50 yards, 2,000 miles, the same. Touch the spark, sound the tone. And the night was alive with a thousand voices fighting to be heard. And each and every one of them connected to me, and my life came alive with a thousand voices tapping out each word, like a thousand people joined with a single heartbeat, tapping out our dit dit da dit da dit 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 da dit da dit 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 da dit da. Everywhere. Marry me.
It's alive with a thousand voices.
May the Lord who watches all watch over thee.
And every one of them connected to me.
Marry me.
So alive with a thousand voices.
May God's heaven be your blanket as you sleep.
Tapping out a dit dit da dit da dit.
Marry me.
Dit da dit da dit.
Marry me.
Dit da dit da.
Ooh, signed Fred.
Message received.
Ladies and gentlemen, after our Sunday service, all first-class passengers are invited to the boat deck, where our bandmaster, Mr. Wallace Hartley, and his ensemble will be playing out of doors for your entertainment. And now, we conclude our service with the hymn, God Lift Me Up. And now follow the bandage out. Isn't it a lovely day?
Yes!
Watching all the ladies in Polynesian fashions on display.
Young Mr. Hartley is playing with Hartley and with him like you never lag. It's a musical treat to hear a band of the beat performing their latest rag.
How do you do, my friends? So good to see you once more. How long since we first met? Has it been 3 days or four? It seems like so much longer than a little weekend jag.
On the ship by ourselves on this glorious afternoon, doing the latest drag.
I love the cool of the breeze, hear the rhythm of the song in your knees, promenading along at your ease, like a feather in the air.
Is that a hint of a chill? When you dance the outdoors, it's a thrill. Keeps your body in healthier still. Take a partner in the everyone is messy with emotion, dancing as across the mighty ocean, moving to the rhythm of the latest track.
Come on and dance with me, please, hear the rhythm of the song in your knees, promenading along at your ease, like a feather in the air.
Is that a hint of a chill when you're dancing outdoors? It's a thrill, keeps your body in healthy and still, take a partner if you dare.
I've been looking for you everywhere. You're not supposed to be here. What have you been up to?
Afternoon dancing.
Afternoon dancing.
It's what they call thé de son.
Back home, it's what they call a crock.
Language, Edgar.
Come on, little girl. I don't really think we belong here.
Oh, applesauce, Edgar. I have danced with the first class, Edgar. It was, oh, such a dream come true.
That class isn't for our kind, Alice.
That won't do. Haven't you noticed, Edgar? These days, nobody's any better than anybody else. Take the Wideners of Philadelphia. I stood right next to them, Edgar. They had this extremely handsome young son, Harry, the Harvard man. I'll tell you the God's honest truth, Edgar. I'd let that man marry our Lucy in a second.
Well, that's half the battle.
You can make fun all you want, but I want more out of life than Indianapolis, Indiana.
Well, that's why I arranged this trip, Alice, to show you the world.
But I don't want to see the world, Edgar. There are so many places I'd rather see first. There are hotels on islands, Edgar. Great resorts near a sandy beach.
That's a world that's beyond our income and our reach.
That's because you've always been satisfied with only one dinky little hardware store instead of branching out. How do you think all those millionaires got their millions, Edgar?
Why don't you just calm down, Alice, and enjoy what we have?
Please don't tell me never. I want this forever, ever. There's a new world around us, Edgar.
Won't you ever give up that view?
I want more than we've got now, Edgar. Why don't you?
I don't know, Alice. What do you suggest we do about it?
I don't know. I'm going for a walk now, Edgar. I have to be alone for a while.
Three bells, Mr. Murdoch.
Thank you, Mr. Lightoller. Hold your course, quartermaster. West, northwest, 292 degrees.
West, northwest, 292 degrees, aye, sir.
Mr. Murdoch, what's our present speed?
Steady at 22 knots, sir.
Have there been any reports of mechanical difficulty since reaching that speed?
No, sir. None at all.
Very good. Increase speed to 23 knots.
Captain, there's been another ice warning, sir. Maseba reports a large berg at 42 degrees north.
42 degrees? That's in total agreement with all the other reports we've received. Except for this one, from the French liner, La Touraine. 41 degrees. Now, that puts it a good deal closer, doesn't it? How do you explain the difference?
It must have been an error in transmission, sir.
The radio. I'll never accept the bloody thing.
I'm afraid it's here to stay, sir.
Which means we'll soon be taking your orders from safe, dry little offices on shore.
It's a brand new world, Captain.
Thank God I will not be around to see it. 23 knots, Mr. Murdoch.
23 knots. Yes, sir. Engine room. Increase speed to 81 revolutions of wing propellers, Mr. Bell.
I'm still waiting, Mr. Strauss.
For what?
The reason you sent our son Jesse a radio message.
He and his cousin Nathan want to make Macy's the largest retail store in the world. Even give away catalogs, like Sears and Roebuck. It's totally crazy.
What did you tell him?
To go ahead. It's a new world out there, Mrs. Strauss. I don't pretend to understand it.
Good evening, sir. Henry Etches, first class steward.
Good evening. Edgar Bean, second class passenger.
Bean, I know that name.
You probably ran into my wife. She likes dancing with millionaires.
Ah, yes. Quite so, sir. My condolences.
That's a far-off look I'm seeing in your eye, Kate. Which far-off place is it you're looking at? America or Ireland?
If you must know, I was thinking about a friend of mine. A very dear friend. It seems she left home because she made a mistake. A mistake she couldn't get rid of.
She should have been more careful.
So, what are you going to do with the rest of your life?
Who knows? Maybe run for Congress again. I'll tell you the truth, I quite liked it there. And the best part is, you don't have to know a thing.
It seems she wants more out of life than I can give her.
Isn't that always the way, sir? I had a wife once.
What happened?
Nothing, I still have her. In all my years, I never saw it so calm.
Is it my imagination, or are we moving faster than ever before?
If my friend were here instead of me, Jim, what would you say to her?
Well, I'd say, what would I call her then?
We're all named Kate, you know that.
So, I'd say, Kate, do you know who the father is?
What a sad question. What do you take her for?
And he refused to go with her. Decent work being hard to find, he probably didn't want to leave his job.
Or his wife. So tell me, Jim Farrell, could a decent feller ever care for a woman who already has a bit of family?
Well made, sir. Astor, that'll cost us some.
It's your deal, Major. Mr. Rogers, your reputation as a fine bridge player is well earned. You play an excellent game.
Thank you, sir.
Either that or you are uncommonly lucky.
Bridge isn't a game of chance, Mr. Astor.
Reminds me of the time I was playing bridge with Lord Raglan during the Crimean campaign, when out of nowhere came 2,000
crazed, godless savages!
I've heard on good authority that there are professional gamblers on board, actual card sharpers that make their living traveling back and forth across the Atlantic.
Gamblers, what nonsense. How do these rumors start?
Oh, you can be sure they're here, Major. How could they pass up the opportunity of fleecing a passenger list like this one? I've even heard talk the notorious Jay Yates is aboard.
I don't remember seeing his name on the passenger list.
Well, you wouldn't, would you? But I'll give you 10-1 he's here somewhere.
A moon, no wind, nothing to spy things by. No wave, no swell, no line or sea meets sky. Stillness, darkness, can't see a thing, says I. The reflection, not a shadow, not a glimpse of light meets the eye.
It's a beautiful night, Mr. Strauss, even though there's no moon. Look at all the stars. Can you find the Big Dipper?
The Big Dipper? Half the time I can't even find our own stateroom. Every time I go out for a walk, finding my way back is an adventure.
Maybe you should drop breadcrumbs.
Can you feel how cold it's getting, Mrs. Strauss? All in the past couple of hours, would you like me to get your first old?
What? And maybe never see you again. No, thank you. I'd rather freeze.
Are you cold then, Katie?
Not now that you've got your arm around me.
But I don't. You're a funny one, Kate McGowan.
Funny? Thanks very much.
Because you come right out with what you want.
And you find that funny, do ya? What kind of girl do you think I am? You think I need to be told what I want? Life's too short for that, me boy.
The weather's quite changed, Mr. Lightoller.
Yes, sir. It turned very cold, only 1 point above freezing.
Ocean temperature's down to 31 degrees, Captain.
Warn the carpenter to check our supply of fresh water, Mr. Murdoch, and tell the engine room to watch the steam winches.
Aye, aye, sir.
There's not much wind, is there?
No, sir. It appears to be a flat calm.
Then we go sail.
See how calm it is, smooth as polished glass. Ah, the open sea, feel the bite in the air. Ah, the open sea, smooth as polished glass.
Good night, gentlemen. I'll be just inside. Keep a sharp watch, the naked eye. That's something you can depend on.
Good night, sir.
Good night.
Crow's Nest, this is the bridge. Keep an eye peeled for ice.
Yes, sir.
Charles, think in 2 days, America. What's the first thing you're going to do once we get there, darling? After marrying me, of course.
Well, I'm going to apply to the sports desk of an important New York newspaper. I'm sure they could use a journalist with my experience.
But you don't know anything about American sports, do you, darling?
Well, their football isn't terribly different from our rugger, except their chaps need a great deal more padding.
They sound like an eminently sensible race.
Let us both hope so.
That's why we're going there.
Good evening, gentlemen.
Madam, this happens to be the smoke room.
So I see.
Women are never permitted in the first-class smoking room, madam.
Don't look so shocked, gentlemen. There's a new world out there.
There's a new world out where?
Mr. Hartley, that's a new melody. What's it called?
Autumn, ma'am. Autumn, shall we all meet in the autumn? Golden and glowing by autumn. Shall we still be best of friends? Best of friends.
Gentlemen, let me introduce myself.
Mrs. Charlotte Cardoz. I know who you are, madam. Recently widowed with a considerably generous inheritance.
And I know about you, Mr. Astor. Recently remarried to a considerably younger wife.
You seem to enjoy shocking people, madam. I have heard you described as a modern woman by people who don't mean it as a compliment.
And I've heard you described as the world's greatest monument to unearned income.
Let breezes blow and turn cold as we continue growing old this autumn. Love newly found may at last.
So, what do you say, gentlemen? I happen to play an excellent game of auction bridge. May I join you?
Where's your sense of occasion, madam? I understand you've just lost your husband.
Yes, but not at cards. And another thing, would you mind putting out those dreadful cigars?
Well, Kate, what immodest thing are you going to say to me next?
I'm going to say, Jim Farrell, will you marry me?
For the love of God, Kate. I know it's a new world we're going to, but we haven't got there yet. Don't you leave nothing for the man to say.
He can say yes. We're gonna need each other when we get there, me boyo, and me baby's gonna need a dad. So we better settle it right now. Will you say yes then?
Well, I might as well. Chances are you wouldn't take no anyway. Well, Kate, aren't you gonna throw me down and kiss me?
Ahead we plow into the darkening night. Can't see the bow. I'll lend to search with lonely starlight. No moon, no wind, nothing to spy things by. No wave, no swell, no line where sea meets sky. sight meets the eye. See how dark it is, smooth as polished glass, on the open sea. Feel the bite in the air, on the open sea, smooth as polished glass, ever on the wing.
Quartermaster, hard a starboard.
Hard a starboard, sir. The helm's hard over.
Engines, full astern.
Full astern, sir.
The bows are acting, Mr. Murdoch. 2 degrees to port.
The distance, Mr. Fleet.
A quarter mile, maybe a little less.
9 degrees, 10, 11, a full point.
Turn, turn, turn!
Look at the size of it.
Looks like the Rock of Bloody Gibraltar.
It's going to pass the starboard.
Yes. It's all right. I think we're going to miss it.
George? 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 Are you there? Wake up! George? George? George McNabbit!
What do you want? Who is it? Benjamin? What's wrong? It's nearly midnight.
George, you hear anything?
Hear anything? No, nothing.
That's exactly the point. The engines. They've stopped.
Stopped? I think you're right.
Wake up, wake up.
Mr. Etches, why have we stopped?
I couldn't say, Mr. Guggenheim, but I don't suppose it's anything much.
Mr. Etches, is something wrong?
I don't think so, madam. Just following orders. Wake up, wake up.
We grazed it, below the waterline on the starboard side.
How bad is it then?
I don't know yet. All stations, damage report. The exact time of contact was 11:40 p.m. One of us should enter it in the log.
If we only grazed it, it couldn't be that bad.
Then we have nothing to worry about, have we?
Report, Mr. Murdoch.
We struck an iceberg, sir. Starboard side. We don't know yet the extent of the damage, but I've taken the liberty of rousing the passengers.
I want them on deck and wearing life preservers. At the very least, they could use a drill. We've never had one, have we?
Wake up, wake up, wake up, wake up, wake up. Wake up, wake up, wake up, wake up, wake up. Wake up, wake up, wake up, wake up, wake up. Wake up, wake up, wake up, wake up, wake up. First class passengers, proceed at once to the salon. Please bring your life preserves and await further instructions.
Almost midnight, strange travels and here.
Look what I found on deck.
Be a sport, John. Be a sport, John. Chip off a piece for my drink.
Ladies and gentlemen, the captain would be most grateful if you would proceed to the Grand Salon. And please, dress warmly.
We're taking water in boiler rooms 4, 5, and 6, sir. In 6, the water's already up to their knees.
Close the watertight doors, Mr. Lightholder, and see that the pumps are activated. Then rouse the carpet. Have him sound the ship.
It's all done, sir.
A position, Mr. Murdoch. Mr. Murdoch, our position.
Latitude, 41 degrees, 44 minutes north. Longitude, 50 degrees, 24 minutes west, sir.
Inform the radio room. For God's sake, Mr. Murdoch, let go of the helm. We're dead in the water.
I'm sorry, sir.
Second-class passengers, proceed to the first-class salon. Please bring your life preserves and await further instructions.
What's happening? Do you know? Have you heard? Do you know? I mean, we heard a rumor. An impact, side impact. I mean, they heard a rumor. What's happened? Do you know? It seems the ship is stopping. Get up now, get us now, put on your water clothing. What's happened? Do you know? It seems the ship is stopping. I understand an iceberg scratched some of her new paint, and the captain doesn't want to go on until she's fixed up, good as new.
Well, I think I'll stay in my cabin and finish my book.
I'm afraid you'll have to go to the first class Grand Salon right away, madam. Captain's orders.
Come on, Alice, here's your chance to mingle with the swells.
Please, you must get your life preservers right away. There's no time to lose.
I can't go up there looking like this. I gotta fix my face.
The ship will be fixed before that, Alice.
Oh, Edgar.
EJ! Why have we stopped? I want an immediate explanation!
We've struck an iceberg, Mr. Ismay.
Well, that was pretty careless, wasn't it?
We're trying to assess the damage, sir.
Damage? What damage?
We're taking on water in the boiler rooms, but we've closed the emergency doors, and I'm quite certain that everything is under control.
Then I'm sure you'll have us underway as soon as possible.
Mr. Andrews is making a complete inspection. If you'll just be patient, sir, we'll have his report the moment it's available.
In the meantime, Captain, I see no need to alarm the passengers.
Third-class passengers, born aback to the well deck. Please find your life preserves and await further instructions.
What is it? What's going on?
There was this terrible scraping noise, and then we just stopped.
What do you want to see you now?
I'm going upstairs and have a look.
You'll wait down here, like you're told.
What's happening?
Andrews.
There's a series of small gashes below the waterline stretching 300 feet along her starboard side. There's water in the forepeak, in the number 1, 2, and 3 holds, in the forepeak, and in 3 of her boiler rooms. In all, 6 of her 16 compartments have been breached.
That's all right. You assured us those compartments are watertight.
She was designed to stay afloat with any 3 flooded, perhaps even 4.
Andrews.
Certainly not 6.
Andrews, what are you saying?
Titanic is sinking, Mr. Ismay.
Nonsense! God himself can sink the ship!
How long has she got, Mr. Andrews?
An hour and a half, Captain. 2 at the most.
Disorienting being here, recently awakened from a dream.
How the lights burn, every crystal bright is a star. Dressed in your pajamas in the grand salon, looks to be bizarre in the extreme. Things could improve if the steward opens the bar. Oh, it's a memory I want to keep. Now I would like to go back to sleep. Dressed in your pajamas in the grand salon, wondering if things are what they seem. Be sure, do you ever know where you are?
Ladies and gentlemen, could I have your attention, please? The captain would appreciate it if all of you were wearing your life preservers.
Mr. Etches! Over here, Mr. Etches.
I'll be right with you, Mr. Astor.
Please, Mr. Etches, what the devil's going on?
Tell me straight, man, are we in any danger?
Danger, Mr. Guggenheim? On this ship? Mr. Astor, please, your life belt. Mr. Guggenheim, please put it on now. Captain's orders. Ladies and gentlemen, wear your life belts. Mrs. Widener, if you would, ma'am. Mr. Thayer, we must insist now. It's a mere formality. There is no cause for concern. We'll be on our way. A minor delay now. A simple precaution. A moment of rest. We'll be on our way. We hardly need stay now. In a moment or two, she'll be right again, traveling west.
See here, Mr. Wretches, I demand to know exactly what's happening.
The latest word, sir, seems to be that she's damaged one of the wing propellers, and we could be delayed for an entire day, sir.
I don't like the way this sounds. Not a bit, not a bit, not a little bit. We spent £1,800. Not a bit, not a bit, not a little bit. This is not the sort of a voyage we paid for. I demand to know what the ship is delayed for right now. How could this ever have come to pass?
Great. Look who's here, it's the second.
Anybody who's anybody?
You're the only person I don't recognize.
Everything is gorgeous in the grand salon, stunningly appointed for the cream. Thousands of bucks gets a trip deluxe without par.
Dressed in your pajamas in the grand salon, looks to me bizarre in the extreme. On the lights here, every crystal bright as a star. Stranger by the story,
Mr. Guggenheim, please, upstairs now. Mrs. Widener, if you would, ma'am, it's a mere formality. There you are.
One away.
On the floor, see it coming underneath the door, and I think behind it there's lots more. It's 2 foot deep in the men's dormitory. The boat's sinking.
What are we supposed to do then? Drown with the mother rats?
Don't be daft. There's lifeboats, they're up there. I've seen them in a snapshot.
Me too, Kate.
Me three, Kate.
How the heck do we get up there? How the heck do we get through that gate? How long are we supposed to wait? Who the heck is looking out for us?
What are you people doing here? Don't you know the ship's on the way down?
Who are you then?
Frederick Barrett, Stoker. We've got to find a way up to the lifeboats. What do you think we're trying to do, man?
Well, we're goners for sure if we can't get to those lifeboats.
Well, we'll have to find another way, all right?
What other way? I've never seen no other way.
I know one. I snuck up to the radio room yesterday and didn't get caught neither.
How could such a terrible thing happen to such a marvelous ship?
Some marvelous ship.
Hurry up before we all drown.
You wait and see. We're going to end up having to swim to America.
Ladies and gentlemen, this way, please. We're headed for the boat deck.
Not so fast, Alice.
Don't dawdle, Edgar. I want to make sure we're on the same lifeboat as the Astors.
Benjamin, I'm afraid. Relax, my dear. The ship could smash into 100 icebergs, and we wouldn't feel a thing.
I've never been in an open boat in my entire life. Charles, promise me we'll stay together no matter what.
I promise.
As long as you keep in mind, I am right where I am.
My diamonds! I've forgotten my diamonds!
Never mind, Maddie. I'll get you much better ones when we get to New York.
Reminds me of the time I was on the China Sea during the Boxer Rebellion of 1900 when our ship was attacked by a godless horde of Malay pirates.
Mrs. Cardoza, if anything should happen to me, I'd be very grateful if you could deliver this message to my sister in Ohio.
I'm sure you'll be all right, Mr. Rogers.
I count things, ma'am. I count cards, I count lifeboats. There aren't enough. I want my sister to know I was aboard this ship.
But your name is on the passenger list, Mr. Rogers.
My actual name is Jay Yates.
The famous card sharper? But I want several hundred dollars from you.
What? Our game is interrupted.
Captain?
Yes, Mr. Andrews?
I'm sure it hasn't escaped your notice, sir, that there are an excess of over 2,200 souls on this ship.
I'm well aware of that.
But space for less than 1,000 in the lifeboats.
I didn't design the ship, Mr. Andrews.
And I didn't instruct the management on the number of boats.
Evidently, 20 boats were enough to satisfy the line. How many would we need to save every man, woman, and child aboard?
54. But the line felt that anything over 20 would have taken away too much deck space from first class, which means well over half of us are going to die in approximately 90 minutes.
Not if a ship arrives.
Do you know of one?
I was just on my way to find out.
Captain, all first and second class passengers are proceeding to the boat deck as ordered. The third class have assembled below the well deck awaiting instructions.
Captain, I don't think the passengers and crew fully comprehend their predicament yet. You'll have to tell them, of course.
Tell them what, Mr. Andrews? That more than 1,200 of them are already dead? I think not, sir. There would be general panic. They would kill each other in order to survive.
Awaiting instructions, Captain.
What? I want you up top, in charge of loading the boats.
But the third class passengers, sir, they're all down
below.
That's
not your concern, Mr. Lightoller. Carry on.
Yes, sir.
Are you taking it upon yourself to decide who lives and who dies? I'd remind you that while you are the captain, you were not hired to play God.
Then let it be God who decides.
It would appear that God is already leaning toward the first class.
How so?
They are the closest to the lifeboats, aren't they?
Then perhaps he'll even the score by sending us a ship.
CQD! Titanic CQD! Situation critical! Repeat! Situation critical!
Radio man, have you reached any ships?
Can't you see? I'm busy! Go bother the captain!
This is the captain!
Oh, I'm so sorry,
sir! Sit down, Mr.
Bright, sir! For the Marconi International
Marine... Sit down, Mr. Bright!
Yes, sir!
And continue!
Yes, sir!
Have you reached any ships' immediate vicinity, Mr. Bright?
7 or 8, sir.
Closest seems to be the Carpathia, Cunard liner.
I know Carpathia, Mr. Bride.
Carpathia responded to our CQD at 11:58 p.m., saying they have turned and are coming hard.
How far is she?
58 miles, sir.
That's more than 4 hours.
Carpathia can't be the only ship in the vicinity, Mr. Bride.
There was one other, the Californian. Her signal is much stronger than the others. I'd place it within 10 miles, but since the accident, she hasn't responded.
Well, why not?
I don't know, sir.
EJ, you've got to do something!
What would you suggest, Mr. Issa May?
We need another ship here immediately!
I'm afraid the nearest one is 4 hours away.
4 hours? We'll be on the bottom by then!
What about Californian? You said she might be close by.
I'm sure she is, sir, but still no response.
Why not? You must demand a response!
Those smaller ships only carry one radio man! He must have signed off and gone to bed!
Well, keep trying, for God's sake!
Listen, there's a new distress call, SOS. It's hardly ever been used, but it's easier to read than CQD, and so
try
maybe...
Try anything you'd like, Mr. Bride. You must rouse that ship!
SOS! Titanic, SOS! Situation critical! Where are you, old man? Come in, Californian!
Surely something can be done to help us.
Thousands on board, trusting and warm, roused from their sleep, sent up above. Unsinkable ship, what is she now? What is she now?
Possibly she won't go down. Possibly she'll stay afloat. Possibly all this could come to an end on a positive note.
Not unless the ship could fly. Not unless we all sprout wings. Honestly, sir, I have built her from scratch, and I know certain things.
If you know so much, why didn't you know to prevent this? What's to become of us all, now that Providence sent us? This is your work, Mr. Andrews! You have done a sin! Where's her leak-proof bulkheads? Where's her double skin? That's your job! If someone must take the blame, it is you! You!
Innocent folk, held in our care, living their lives, dreaming their dreams. Dreaming their dreams.
Possibly a ship will come. Possibly we'll all be saved.
Really, sir, listen, we're hemorrhaging fast. It's our hole that's been staved.
Couldn't you design it right? Whoever heard of steel that rips?
Ismay, I'm just in the business of building. It's God who sinks ships.
There stands the captain who sailed us straight into disaster.
Oh, now it's the captain's turn, pray, who urged him to go faster. Well, then thank you, Mr. Ismay, for your contribution. Now please pray for some miraculous solution. Your timing is perfect. Now help us, please, if you can.
Who called for speed and to break every record? Who had to keep all the millionaires happy?
How dare you, Smith? I will not stand here and indict it. Who ignored warnings of icebergs when sighted? Who, sir, refused to extend up the bulkheads?
You, sir, to give the first class bigger staterooms?
Who undermined the position of captain?
And who took a course for 2 non-weather season?
Who kept insisting we land the Masuda?
And who said that?
And who had to have built the largest and fastest?
Who did it? Who did it? Who did it? Who did it?
Captain! Never mind. I'm sorry.
Possibly the Lord will act.
Possible he will provide.
and indicate how our unthinkable fates can be somehow denied. Somehow denied.
Your work, no one else's.
My doing, no one else's.
There's only one captain, and I was in charge. This is my ship, no one else's.
Women and children will commence boarding the lifeboats.
Men will please stand back.
You and I are getting in the lifeboat. Father will be staying here a while. It will be like rowing in the Serpentine. Come along now, let us have a smile.
I'll collect you both tomorrow morning, you and this beloved son of mine.
Madam, step this way into the lifeboat.
Mr. Strauss, by all means, take a place.
No, I will not go before the younger men. Ida, you must go now.
What about you?
Ida, I'm telling you, get into a lifeboat.
I refuse.
Refuse? How can you refuse? After 40 years, you cannot refuse.
I'm sorry, Isidore, but after 40 years, how can I leave you now?
Because you must be saved.
For what? To live without you? Absolutely not.
Ida.
Where you go, I go.
You must get in. Please step this way. There is no time. Please don't delay. This is the last lift.
Must
be lower now. You must get in. Please step this way. There is no time. Please don't delay. This is the last lift. It must be lower now.
Kate, take it for God's sake.
I'm not going without you, Jim. I don't want to be a widow before I'm a bride.
You're going to be a ladies' maid. A ladies' maid in America.
This boat needs two men at the oar.
No!
You,
no!
Mr. Fleet.
No!
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir.
You, Stoker.
Barrett, sir.
Mr. Barrett, can you row a boat?
I don't know, sir. I never tried.
I can row, sir. I was fisherman by trade.
Then get in, man. Hurry.
Yes, I will, sir. Thank you, sir. Sorry, mate. Good luck to you, mate.
Get into the boat, Alice.
Oh, Edgar, I'm so sorry about all the horrible...
Alice, do as I say.
I love you, Edgar. No, please. I love you. No, please. Please.
Say goodbye and keep your image in my memory's eye, and all this love of ours will soar. Come dawn or danger, we'll meet tomorrow and have each other.
Give us tomorrow.
all gone, it seems.
I can still see my wife. I told her I'd be following.
Only thing you could do.
Mine actually believed it. Of course, she's only 19.
Death rarely occurs to the young, nor does anything else for that matter.
It's rather a pity, actually. It was terribly good crossing up till now. So many agreeable people.
A few too many climbers, I thought. Lately, I've noticed anyone with a few million dollars considers themselves rich.
Do you think that, perhaps, we had this coming?
What are you saying, man?
Benjamin, what have we ever done?
I can't help but remembering something that Balzac wrote. He said, "Behind every great fortune lies a great crime." So let's confess. Who wants to start?
That water looks colder than a polar bear's keister. And it won't be long until we're in it up 2 hours. Edgar Bean, hardware.
Jay Yates, gambler.
That must be interesting work.
How about a game of two-handed stud to pass the time?
Sure, why not?
I warn you, I cheat.
So what? I wasn't gonna pay you anyway.
So that was your wife you were saying goodbye to then?
Almost. We were going to be married when we got to New York.
Yeah. I was to be married when I got back to England.
Looks like we're both gonna wind up bachelors.
It could be worse, sir.
Really? How?
At least we're not making any widows, are we?
Good point. What do you gentlemen say to a good, stiff drink?
I say one won't be nearly enough.
All 20 boats have been launched, Captain.
Thank you. You have a remarkably sunny disposition, boy. How old are you?
14, sir.
I was a cabin boy when I was 14. What are you called?
Edward, sir.
Really? So am I.
All of the ladies in first class, except one, are safely away, Captain.
Thank you, Miss Wretches.
I'm afraid most of the gentlemen we know are still aboard. There's no hope, I suppose. I see. Who could have imagined it, sir? Everyone said she was unsinkable.
Mr. Ismay was fond of boasting that Titanic was her own lifeboat.
That must have been before he used one of the little ones to save his own skin.
More than anything else, the man wanted a legend. Well, now he's got one.
Captain, I want you to know that I take full responsibility. I was the ranking officer on the bridge at the time of... If I were a fit master, I would have rammed the iceberg head on. We would have staved the bow, perhaps lost a few people. But the ship would have survived.
I'm sure you did what you thought best at the time, Mr. Murdoch.
You expected more of me, sir. You had every right. But your expectations were misplaced.
The truth is, I've been uncommonly lucky. In my 43 years at sea, I've served on them all of the White Star ships. And in all that time, I've never been in, nor even seen, a shipwreck or any other calamity worth speaking of.
Thousands on board, each in his class. You are the master of all that must pass. Yours to set course, yours to command. Our souls in the palm of your hand. You hold our souls in the palm of your
Are you cold, Mama?
Lately, I'm always cold.
Come, I'll blow on your fingers.
Save your breath.
What for?
Mr. Strauss.
Mr. Etches.
Mrs. Strauss, a glass of champagne, perhaps.
Champagne? Why? Do you think we have something to celebrate?
I brought the Cristal, 1898. It's the last bottle left.
My goodness, it would be a shame to open it.
Under the circumstances, madam, I think it would be a shame not to.
Won't you join us for a glass, Mr. Etches?
Later, perhaps, sir. I still have my regular people to attend. May I say, it has been a great pleasure over the years serving you both.
To us.
Who else? No, you're still a pretty good-looking fella.
I would have to be to keep such a beautiful wife.
Still, the way I love you still lives in my heart.
After all of the years we've been
became mine, whispered the words,
I will. I loved you then, and I love you.
sacrifice we made kept us as one and will. I love to then, and I love you.
I declare this vessel lost. From now on, it's every man for himself.
Just a cursory look at the blueprints here shows the weaknesses that we have missed. How the water poured in a 300-foot gash and caused the bow to flood and to list. And it filled to the top of separate watertight compartments and began to overflow because the walls in between the compartments are too low. She's only sinking because these bulkheads stop a deck too low. But here's a thought. Take a line and extend up the walls to the brig. It's just a small redesign, but when it's done, then I know she can't sink. Like this. Like this. Like this. And then like this.
Mr. Andrews! Aren't you gonna make a go of it? Mr. Andrews!
Will start to plunge beneath the surface, the water lapping at our feet. Down sinks the bow, up flies the stern to the sky, the panicked people in retreat. 1,000 strong, they'll climb up toward the aft deck. They'll cling there desperately like bees to a hive. There, they'll hold fast, doomed to the last, lost and abandoned, and all still alive. A few of them will hang there from the railings, as one by one they'll drop away. More than 250 feet they will fall, and after that I cannot say. I will not say. The rest, its swarms will overrun the boat deck. They'll lose all sense of right and wrong. It will be every man for himself, all right. The weak voted with all the strong. First class and third and second will mean nothing. And sheer humanity alone will prevail. One single class, brute, harsh, and crass. That's what will come of the world that sets sail. Autumn, shall we all meet in the autumn? Shall we all meet in the autumn?
One moment, the ship was there, and the next she was gone.
There were over 1,000 poor souls floundering in the freezing water.
We wanted to go back for them, of course, to pick them up.
But they'd have swamped us. Then no one could have survived.
The sound they made was deafening, like there was an entire football stadium out there in the dark somewhere.
I'm ashamed to say it. I was relieved.
I'll hear those voices for the rest of my life.
Why shouldn't I have taken that place on the lifeboat? It would have gone empty.
There were more than 450 empty seats in the lifeboats. It was so very cold.
The women were so brave, alone in the dark in the middle of the ocean.
If only I'd seen that iceberg before it was too late.
If only they hadn't kept increasing the speed.
If only the Californian had heard my call. I stayed with the key till the very end. They could have saved every man, woman, and child aboard.
We were only 95 miles from dry land.
When dawn came, we could see ice everywhere. It was all bathed in pink, and hundreds of deck chairs floating in the water.
And all them poor women and children in third class, who never even made it to the lifeboats.
And all 50 bellboys, none more than 13 years old, went to their deaths without a whimper.
All of the musicians who kept on playing autumn, right to the very end.
With only 711 survivors, 1,517 souls lost their lives.
Including the man I called my husband.
And my husband. And my husband. My husband. And my husband.
In a matter of only a few minutes, the largest moving object on Earth had totally disappeared.
Fare thee well. Heaven be your blanket as you softly sleep.
Softly sleep. In every age, mankind attempts to fabricate great works at once magnificent and impossible. On desert sands, from mountains of stone, a pyramid. From flying buttresses alone, a wall of light. A chapel ceiling screaming, one man's ecstasy. One man's ecstasy. Miracles them all, China's endless wall. Stone hangs upon and on the Duomo. Aqueducts of Rome. We did not attempt to make with mammoth blocks of stone a giant pyramid. No, not a pyramid. Nor Gothic walls that radiate with light. Our task was to dream upon and then create a civilization, sleek and fast, at once a poem and a profession of physical engineering, at once a poem and a profession of physical engineering.